Yes, right now. We must have the whole truth. This is the true light coming to you live from live tapes. The answers to all your questions. We don't need false prophets. We don't need misinformed teachers that don't know how to teach. We don't need leaders that don't know how to lead. That's right, he's here right now with us on earth, incarnated in human form, with the total truth. You have to hear it to believe it. نشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الحمد لله الوالي الكريم، وصلى الله على أنبياء أجمعين، والمسيح والمحدي والمجدد لمن مرسلين. Are we not the bearers of witness that nothing would exist if Allah didn't create it? And that He is alone and has no partners? And that all gratitude is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the sustainer of all the boundless universes. All gratitude is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the generous eternal friend. And send salutations of Allah on all of His prophets and His apostles. And on the Messiah, the anointed one. And on the Mahdi, the guide. And on the Mujaddid, the reform, which was all sent from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send greetings and we send peace throughout the boundless universe to all. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.
You are now listening to The True Light with Sayyid al-Imam Isa al-Hadi al-Mahdi in a live question and answer session.
I was told that you're saving, you're serving Satan, so how could you hate the white people and love black when God say that he came to save the world?
Where does it say in the Bible that God came to save the world?
I don't see it.
It's not in the Bible. It says right in there that Jesus came to the lost sheep of the house of Israel only. It tells you right in John, it tells you in Hebrews. Over and over again it says it. Came to the lost sheep in Matthew 15, for instance, when he's being confronted with a Canaanite woman who he refuses to heal. Mind you, Jesus refuses to heal this Canaanite woman. This is who you're saying God, yet he won't heal somebody. Why didn't Jesus heal this woman in Matthew 15? Read Matthew 15, everyone.
Begin with verse 21. It says, then Jesus went thence and departed unto the coast of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a woman of Canaan came out of the same coast and cried unto him, saying, have mercy on me, O Lord, thou son of David. My daughter is grievously vexed with the devil. But he answered her not a word. And his disciples came and besought him, saying, send her away, for she crieth after us. But he answered and said,
now make note that this is what Jesus said. Because this is, of course, in your Bible, it should be in your red print, I think. Is it in red in your Bibles?
Oh, yes.
Okay, this is what Jesus says concerning this woman. And this is what he says concerning himself. Go ahead.
I am not sent but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel.
Why do people keep saying Jesus was sent to everybody in the world when the Bible right here says he wasn't? Why do they keep lying on Jesus? He never said these things. Christians made these things up. He said he was only sent to the lost sheep of Israel only. So why do people, he's not interested in the Yugoslavians, and he's not interested in the people of Ireland, he's not interested in people in London, he's not interested in people in France, he's not interested in people in Spain, he's not interested in none of the people but the lost sheep. Notice he says lost here. Because he was there standing amongst people who were calling themselves Jews. He was right there with people calling themselves Jews. But what did he say? Talking to, now here the disciples are standing there, correct? And these disciples also claim to be of the house of Israel, most of them, correct? But notice what he says about that. What are they? Are they found? Did he say, I was not sent for the lost, but now found? He's talking to them and still saying they're not there. Read it again.
But he answered and said, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel.
What, he's not standing? They're still lost and he's talking to them? He knew that he was sent to a people that had not yet come. That's why he said in John that it's better for him to go. Because he had many things to say unto them, but they could not bear them yet. So they could easily say, they could say we worship the devil if they wish. We worship what Jesus worshipped. Allah or Ilah, the same word. We worship what Jesus worshipped. If they want to say that, they worship Jesus. We don't worship Jesus. We worship what Jesus worshipped. which is the Father of the heavens and the earth, our Father who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. That's what Jesus said. Not our Father who was in heaven and has now come down to earth as his Son. That's not what Jesus says in Matthew. Read what Jesus says in the Lord's Prayer concerning the Father. Our Father who art where?
In heaven.
Now this is Jesus telling people to pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed or holy be thy name. Is Jesus' name holy then? Or is his Father's name holy? His Father's name. This is what he says. You know what the problem is? People are busy listening to preachers, teachers, and false prophets and prophecies. Because a whole lot of women preachers out there too now. And they're just making up their own doctrine about the Bible without even an understanding. They're philosophizing and opinionating, and they're just not using facts. Go directly to the Bible, read it word for word, and see what it says. Jesus right there tells everybody who he was sent to. He was sent to Israel. Was he planning on making a new religion then? No, because the people of Israel already had laws they followed. They followed the books of Moshe. They followed the laws of Israel. They had certain laws they kept. The 50th day of the month Nisan was Pentecost. So what do these people make up a church called the Pentecostal church for? That had to do with the coming in of the new season in Judaism. And that was never doing no new church. They baptized with water and with fire. The fire baptism was a sacrifice. The water baptism was total submerging into water. Where did they get this Baptist church from? Luther was a man who went up against the churches of England and they formed a church called the Lutherans. Everybody bears witness to Yahuwah. Because it says like in St. John, I sent to bear witness to him. Everyone bears witness to Yahuwah, which they mistranslated as Jehovah and called themselves Jehovah Witnesses. They're not saying nothing slick. And Jesus says, right, render unto Caesar what is Caesar's, and unto the Lord what is the Lord. Caesar was the governor of what place? Of Rome, right? So there's no way you can be a Roman Catholic, because Jesus separated Rome from the kingdom of God. He said, render unto Caesar what is Caesar's, and unto the Lord what is the Lord. So there's no such thing as a Roman Catholic. So where did you get that one from? Can I keep going, or can y'all see the rest of them? They made these things up. Lutherans, Pentecostals, Baptists, Jehovah's Witnesses. They took incidents out of the law and made whole congregations upon them. You know how come they did that? Because in St. John, Jesus told them they couldn't establish the church yet. He said, he will build his church. He looked at Peter, Cephas, and said, I'll build my church upon this rock. Using him as an example, as a person. He will do it. Not Peter, not Paul. But they went out after him, after he openly told these people. What did he say? I have yet many things to say unto you, however, you cannot bear them yet. Correct? This is St. John chapter 7. Does he not say that? So if I am your teacher, and I have not finished teaching you, how the heck are you going to go set up a school to teach? He told he didn't finish teaching them yet. That means the Christians are setting up a school of thought, and the doctrine and the curriculum is not yet complete. How is that possible? There's many things I have to say unto you, however you cannot bear them yet. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, the Comforter, by the way, he shall not speak of himself, only that which he hears shall he speak, and he shall glorify the Holy. They say, that's the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost was with Jesus when he was baptized in the Jordan by John the Baptist. The Holy Ghost visited Mary to tell her she was going to be pregnant. The Holy Ghost visited Zachariah to tell him he couldn't speak. The Holy Ghost visited Elizabeth. The Holy Ghost visited Sarah and Abraham. The Holy Ghost visited Jacob in the wilderness. The Holy Ghost has been here since the foundation of the world. What is this stuff? The Holy Ghost is coming all of a sudden like it's something new. Jesus didn't say that. He said, I will send you what? I will send you another comforter. What does the word another mean even in English? Somebody tell me what the meaning of another is. Do you know?
There's one and there'll be another one.
Well, there it is. You have one thing and there'll be another like it. Now, he said he'll send another comforter. So either the angel Gabriel is going to come to another woman and she is going to conceive another child born of the Holy Spirit like him. You see? Which will make another comforter. Or he meant something else. Somebody else that will be guided by the Holy Spirit, which the Holy Quran confirms. That the angel Gabriel, the Holy Spirit, came to Muhammad while he was in the cave and told him to read. That was that other comforter. The angel Gabriel came to another man, and that man was sent forth into the world with the word of the Most High. That man was called Muhammad. And that word that he had was called Kalima. La ilaha illallah. Wahdahu la sharika lahu. That was the word Muhammad put forth, that Jesus spoke about, that there is no creator except one, and besides him there is none.
In the family states that the children in slave will, there will be children in slave for 400 years, right? And they will come out abundantly. But do they mean, does it mean Muslims are black and gone?
If you had any difficulty in hearing this question, the question was, the Bible states that there will be a bondage for 400 years, and then these people will come out with great substance. Does that mean the Muslims are blacks as a whole?
If you go back to who we're speaking of, you're speaking of either one or two bondages, all right? One of the bondages is the children of Jacob, who is Isaac's son, who had his name changed to Israel, and his sons became known as Yisrael, right? Or Ben Israel, sons of Israel. And they went into bondage in Egypt. Under who?
Yeah.
Under Egyptians. They were not under bondage of any Amorites. They were not under the bondage of none other than the Egyptians, correct?
Right.
Okay. And they went and they had their Exodus, which is why they have all the holidays today, which meant the day came when they left Egypt. Is that a fact? So that eliminates the scripture talking about them. Okay, now we come down to another bondage. Where, but before we get into that bondage, let's get into something that Jesus said. Because he was in between the bondage of the original Israel and the second bondage of Abraham's seed. Okay? And Jesus is going to tell us who these people are in his Beatitudes. He says, blessed are the what? The peacemakers. For they shall be called the what? The children of God, right? Now listen to that statement. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Because in St. John chapter 1, he says, as many as believe in me, they too shall be called the sons of. So now, he's telling you that the people that will believe in him will also be called the peacemakers. Now, in Matthew 24, however, he says, in the latter day, many shall come in my name and say they are of Christ and are not. You follow? So, we establish here that he called his followers peacemakers, and they will be the sons of God. Then he spoke of another people who will come in his name, and they're not of him. Now, Muslims do not call themselves Christians. Christians call themselves Christians supposedly because they're coming in the name of who? Christ. Right? And Christ told us in Matthew 24 when talking to the disciples, many shall come in my name and say they are of him but not. Now, he also mentioned, in case the question comes up, about people who say they are him in Matthew 24. That is a different type of idiot. And then he spoke of another people, many false prophets would come. And that is another type of idiot. So we have, in the world today, people that are saying they are Christ, right? And we have people that are saying they are prophets. Then we have people that have come in Christ's name and saying they are of him and they're not. Do you understand that? But he describes in the Beatitudes by the word peacemaker. If we go back to the Aramaic or the Hebrew or the Arabic, which are all the same language, different dialects, when they use the word peace, they use the word either shalom or salam. You understand? And when they want to change it into a noun to identify to someone, they always add a M, U, or M-A on it in those languages. So if you take the word salam and you add the prefix to it, one who is of this here, to make it a noun, a name, it becomes M-U, salam. Read that. What would that spell? It would say mu, right? One who is salam. Now say mu and salam fast. This is what Jesus said. He said, blessed are the, they shall be called. the sons of God, the children of God. And as many believe on my name, there's many Muslims out there who don't believe in Jesus. You meet a lot of Sunni Muslims who worship in a subtle kind of way Muhammad. And they don't acknowledge Jesus as the Messiah who would come in the latter day. You follow that? So as many of them that believe, the same shall be saved. Am I overloading you?
No.
Okay, I want you to bear with that. Because there's quotes to support things that happen that people don't realize. Why? Many people come along saying they're Christian or Christ. If you try to establish with these people, what did Jesus teach, they get lost. Here's how we'll find out about the false people. Did Jesus bring a new religion, is the question.
No.
That's right. But we can go on and let's, for everybody's there, if they have a pencil and paper, let's write it down and let's open our Bible. You have a Bible with you, eh? Open your Bible to Matthew 5. Turn to verse 17. I want you all to write these down because this is your ammunition when you go out to spread the gospel so you can defend your faith.
Okay.
Read it to us. This is Jesus speaking. I think in most Bibles they put it in red for some crazy reason to say that this is Jesus. But read what it says.
Think not that I come to destroy the Lord or the prophet. I am not come to destroy but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall nowise pass from the law till all be fulfilled.
Okay, now the reason why I picked these two quotes out is for several reasons. One is, they left the Hebrew in it. Jot and tittle. It's from yot and tittle. Two Hebrew letters. The smallest letter in the Hebrew language is the letter yot. It's a tiny little thing, looks like a comma. Alright, now Jesus is speaking about the law. And he says, tell his people, and mainly Paul and these type of people who came and altered the law, don't think that I came to do what?
Destroy.
To destroy the law of the prophets, not just of Moses, which he mentions in St. John chapter 1 that the law came by way of Moses. You see? But he said all the prophets in plural prior to him. He did not come and destroy the law of the prophets. What does the word destroy mean? To do away with. To get rid of. To break up. So that meant that Jesus was establishing in this verse that he was living by the same law of the prophets before him. Correct?
Right.
If you turn to Romans 3:31.
Okay.
Read it for us.
Do we then make void the law through faith? God forbid. Yea, we establish the law.
You see that? Again, they tell us about the establishment of the law. If we went on to 4, we'll find out whose law they're talking about. What shall we say then? That Abraham, our father, pertaining to the flesh, has found, because this is a question to ask him. But we're talking about some law, and this law is pertaining to whom? Apparently. What prophet is mentioned here?
Abraham.
It'll go on to speak about who the covenant's hand should fall into, whether it's Ishmael or Isaac. And in this one, it'll speak of if the covenant has fallen into Ishmael's hands, not Isaac's, because Ishmael had the covenant of the flesh, and Isaac had the covenant of the promise, right? And it says right there, pertaining to the flesh, which is the covenant of the circumcision which was given to the son Ishmael from the Egyptian wife Hagar, not Isaac, which is of course the descendants of the Muslims. So Jesus is confessing at this point that the law he lived by is the same law of Abraham, and it will end up with the Muslims. Let me go on with more quotes. Unless you have a question.
Yeah, when I asked a Christian about Ishmael, they said that since Jesus came, he didn't say anything about Ishmael, or it was the Jews. So there's no way to say that Ishmael were to be successor of the covenant in the New Testament.
I don't have no argument with Jesus saying he came to teach the Jews. But I have an argument with the Christians saying that and not realizing what they're saying. I just showed you one step.
came to teach the law to Israel, right?
Right.
Not the Gentiles.
I'm going to go on.
We're just going to read and write and let the Bible teach us instead of men. Okay?
You have been listening to The True Light, a question and answer session with Saeed Al-Imamisa Al-Hadi Al-Mahdi. Do you want to know the truth? Can you face the truth? Be sure to read the most dynamic books in history, authored by Saeed Al-Imamisa Al-Hadi Al-Mahdi, on such subjects as, what is a Muslim? Where is the tabernacle of the Most High? Should Muslims observe the Sabbath? Was Christ really crucified? Who was the Comforter? Now let us return to the true light with Saeed Al-Imam Isa Al-Hadi Al-Mahdi. Remember, you are the light, and you have the power over all things.
Matthew 15:24, turn to it. Hope you all write these things down. Some of you all at least.
But he answered and said, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the coast of Israel.
Jesus told people right there who he was sent to. Who did he say he was sent to?
The lost, to the children.
Of Israel only, right?
Right.
Now, let's see what he says in Matthew 18:11.
For the Son of Man is come to save that which was lost.
Now, what did he say in 15:24? I came to the what?
Lost sheep.
I see the word lost there again? Lost? You don't see it?
Okay,
Matthew 15:24. Right. I am not sent but to the lost.
Sheep of the house of Israel.
But the catchword here is lost. Okay?
Right.
Now when we go to the other one, 18:11 of Matthew, it says, for the Son of Man, speaking of Jesus, is come to save that which was
lost.
He did not come for anybody else.
Right.
Let's go on. Matthew 28:19.
Okay.
What did he say?
Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
Now people will presuppose this therefore to mean to go out and teach everybody the gospel. Right? But then that would be a contradiction to what Jesus just said. But the fact that he mentions that the children of Israel are lost means that they are scattered throughout the nations. You see?
Okay, right.
And his disciples must go find them, not go to Galatians and teach the Galatians like Paul did and teach Gentiles. And let's go on. And let's read Matthew 19:28.
And Jesus said unto them, verily I say unto you, that he which hath followed me
is a regeneration.
When the Son of Man shall sit in the throne of his glory, he also shall sit upon the 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel.
Who will he judge?
The 12 tribes of Israel.
Will he judge Christians and Gentiles and people that are not Israel?
No.
Okay. Let's go on. So let's go let the Bible teach us. Okay?
Okay.
Let's go ahead.
Why is the Old Testament being erased from the...
Why is it?
The Old Testament. Being erased from the complete Bible.
The Old Testament is not being erased from the Bible.
No, but according to most Christian churches, you only get the New Testament.
Because they know that in reading the Old Testament, every time someone comes up with what I'm showing now, by this quote, that Jesus did not, okay, run people, right? Acts 11:19. Let's see what happens, and then I'll tell you why.
Okay.
Beautiful.
Now there which were scattered abroad upon the persecution that arose about Stephen traveled as far as Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch, preaching the word to none, but unto the Jews only.
Who were they teaching?
The Jews only.
Now, what is wrong with these people into thinking that they got a new religion? Called Christianity. Jesus did not advocate Christianity. Jesus told the disciples who to teach only, who he was sent to only. Now the reason why Paul and them had to do that because they were confronted with a very serious situation. You know what it was? Conversion. They were confronted with conversion. Converting a man. That means when you convert a grown man who's not circumcised, he has to go and get the skin of his flesh cut. Conversion becomes very difficult
circumcision in front of a human being. In order for you to be saved, you have to go get your foreskin cut off and stay in agony for 10 days. See, when a baby is circumcised with a straight knife, it's one thing. When a grown man gets circumcised, it's another whole thing. You understand? So Paul and them were confronted with trying to convert people who had been, who were Jews, who had started living like Gentiles. And he couldn't do it. So they started to modernize the religion. You see? They changed the Sabbath day for convenience. They stopped the circumcision. They started drinking wine that was intoxic, which could make them drunk. Started eating the flesh of the pig. They started to take, they took their caps off their head because they wanted to be distinguished as a new sect of Jews. They were not thought to be Christians until Antioch in Greece. The brother put that on the board. They were first called Christians in Antioch. All the time that they were in Judea and Jerusalem and Nazareth, they were living by the law of Israel like every other Jew. The Greeks called them Christians. You understand? So the reason why they try to eliminate the New Old Testament is because the Old Testament is the law. And they find it in Leviticus chapter 7 verse 11, it tells them to stop eating pork. What would a Christian picnic be without pork? Christians, they're the only people in the world that eat pork the way they do. You see? They would have to let their beards grow. Like the law in Leviticus says, to let your beard grow. They would have to wear their heads covered in the mouth in the temple, take their shoes off, because the Bible says that the angel spoke to Moses and said, remove your shoes because this is holy ground. Christians trod the dirt from the street right into the temple. Right? They did not want to live by these strict laws that Jesus lived by. Jesus lived by the Passover, Yom Kippur, Rosh Hashanah, and all of the Judaic laws, he followed them. And then, when he got ready to leave, because they didn't accept him, in St. John chapter 7, that's when he told them of another one that would come. A comforter that would come. And then the Christian said, well, this comforter he's talking about is the Holy Ghost. Correct? However, Jesus made it a thing that he said, if I don't go, he cannot come. Now, we know that Jesus received the Holy Ghost when he was baptized in the Jordan by John the Baptist. Right? The dove descended upon him. So therefore, the comforter, or the Holy Ghost, I should say, had already been there. And he sent his disciples out to teach of the Holy Ghost. So they were already there. So this comforter could not have been the Holy Ghost. There was someone who was endowed with the Holy Ghost like Jesus was endowed with the Holy Ghost. A man who had the Spirit of the Most High moving through him, which would make him like the Holy Ghost, just like Jesus. Jesus was born with the Holy Spirit many times, right? Right. Who was that man who came after Jesus who was a prophet? Because we found out that when the Pharisees asked John about the Messiah, you found out that that Messiah was who? Jesus. When they asked him about Elijah, Jesus then explained that John the Baptist didn't know that he was Elijah. But what about the prophet they asked him about? Who was this prophet who came after Jesus? None other than, you can say it, Muhammad. Who Jesus said is one worthy of praise. But not only that, the Holy Quran, in the seventh chapter, the 158, mentions that this man Muhammad is the one mentioned in the old scripture. But Muslims are so thick that they don't read the scriptures to find out what they're talking about. They're so busy listening to white Arabs who don't know what they're talking about. Open your Holy Quran, anyone, to the seventh chapter. Now read what it says in 157.
And ordained for us good in this world.
Okay, that's, see, I'm looking at it in Arabic. I think you have to come down one then. Come to 158.
Okay. Those who follow the messenger, the prophet, the immaculate one, whom they find is mentioned in the Torah and the gospel which are with them. He enjoins on them good and forbids them evil.
Remember Jesus said that about the comforter? He will enjoin good and prevent evil? There's a book written that seems to have the exact same thing about this man Muhammad. Go ahead.
And make law lawful for them, the good things and forbid them to fast, and remove from them your burden and your shackles that were made upon them. So those who shall believe in him, the honor and support.
You see that? You can see why a Christian preacher and a white man does not want black people to understand the Quran. Because if they did understand the Quran, they see that it's saying the exact same thing, you know, that Jesus foretold. And that's what he's trying to prevent our people from finding out who this comforter is and what he means to us.
And you said something about wine, I think, a while ago. Didn't Jesus drink wine?
Yes, and wine was not even unlawful for Muslims. That's not what's unlawful. Intoxication is what's unlawful. They were not to drink wine as a form of pleasure or entertainment. It was drunk at the broken, when they broke the Sabbath, and at certain holidays, and at certain wedding receptions and things. And when Jesus saw that people was drunk, that's why he told his mother Mary he did not want to turn the water to wine. That's why he was upset. And he said, woman, he spoke to his mother, not as mother, but he said, woman, when she said, well, my son didn't turn the water into wine. He was angry. You see? Wine was not supposed to be drank to make one drunk. It was not intended for that. He says, Noah's time, a curse came out of people becoming intoxicated. So in the Holy Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbids us to get drunk. They use the word khamra, intoxication. But Muslims who can't read the language are always interpreting it wrong and translating it wrong. Wine was never forbidden. It was the intoxicating effect that was forbidden. And Jesus and them, when they took wine, they did the dinner and their ceremonies, never a bottle of wine to get ripped.
Okay? And when did Jesus and ripped? He always ripped his mother as a woman.
Why did he? Yeah. At the party in Cana. At the wedding, when she asked Jesus to turn water into wine, he was vexed at that point.
But I believe even at the crucifixion, he also ripped her to Mary as
well. Well, that wasn't Jesus. That was Judas at the crucifixion. And Mary, according to the Bible, was so far away from the cross, Jesus couldn't talk to her anyway. We went through a whole bunch of contradictions last week about that very subject.
Alright. UFO, UFO is for real. Is that for real?
Alright, that's a very good point. I want you to read this now. I like to stay in the Bible. It's fair this way, right? You can't go out and say, this guy just talks off the top of his head. You have to say, every time he says something, he does what? With a Bible quote.
Right.
I want you to turn your Bible to Matthew 2:9. And I want you to read it to me. This is speaking about the birth of the Messiah and the coming of the so-called wise men. What does it say in 2:9?
When they had heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was.
Okay, let's establish one thing. Scientifically, we gotta establish that these texts that we call scriptures are supposed to be divinely inspired. And therefore, the Almighty, creator of the heaven and the earth, he knows certain things you and I can't begin to conceive. One is, the sun does not really rise or set, right? So if you see in the Bible it says the sun rises or sets, somebody's playing games. Because he would be looking down, he would never be looking up to see it rise and set. So man has to write that. You got the point? Okay, now speaking of sun, stars are suns. You studied a little bit about astronomy, not astrology, astronomy. Stars are suns. And your sun, which is approximately 19 million miles away from the Earth, and it varies according to season, is not by far one of the largest stars. Okay? Now we know a scientific fact is when you look up at night and you see a star, it's not really there. You're seeing the remains of the light. The star has already left and burnt out. Okay? Alright. However, in this quote in the Bible, which is supposed to be divinely inspired, we get a certain inclination about a star that started in the east and drove over to Bethlehem and stopped. Right? Now let's forget the Christmas story and all that stuff that y'all like so much, and let's get into this fact scientifically. One star was to be over Bethlehem. It would be so big then they wouldn't know what town Jesus was in. Stars are bigger than the sun. Big, big, big. First of all, and second of all, stars don't pick up and go places and stop. You understand the point I'm making?
Okay, right.
You're talking about a ship. The angels used to use ships, light, like y'all explained earlier with Ezekiel. And they would appear to people who were not informed in the advanced sciences of astronomy. When they see a light, they would immediately say star. It was a bright light, it was the sun, it was a somewhat bright light, it was the moon, and everything else that lit up the sky was a star. In Revelation, when John sees the star, as he called it, fall and hit the earth, he called that bomb that he saw come out that plane a star. You see? These are ships. This was a ship that guided the wise men to where the Messiah was. Now, the reason why the white man, as he's called, calls it a UFO, is because he is so honest in what he does that he's really unhonest.
I am.
Let me tell you why I say that. I'll get back to you. Because UFO deviates something. What does that mean?
Unidentified flying
object. Unidentified flying objects. It's an object, it's flying, and I don't know what it is. But what he does is gives it a name, UFO, and you begin to believe that's the name. You see? You start saying UFO is a name. UFO is a statement saying I don't know what it is. So the star mentioned in the Bible of Bethlehem was a ship. No star picks up and goes from the east to the west and stops. So if you study this science, the scripture is supposed to come from the Most High. You know that. Go ahead.
Whatever UFO am, around, right?
If UFOs are around?
No, I mean, whatever it comes around.
Aye.
Does it bring a message or something to someone?
No. Every angel that you ever hear about in scripture is a UFO. In Ezekiel, anybody who comes into the Earth's atmosphere from another galaxy or another dimension or another plane, who comes in and because of their aura, their holler, their light around them, is cited as some beam of light, is therewith declared an unidentifiable flying object. Now, there are beings walking the earth today as human beings, taking on human forms to study human nature, to try to help you not totally destroy yourself. They have to take on a human form and walk amongst you, because if they stay in their divine form, your devil friend, who happens to also be an alien from Saturn here, would want to dissect them, would want to operate, want to figure out what makes them tick. So they take on the form of human beings to mingle amongst mortals, to help man, to try to coerce man to stop destroying himself. But man has been so caught up in the delicacies of the devil, it's very difficult to wake him up to who he is.
In the Bible it says, man and mankind. What does it mean when...
Well, in English, man and mankind means what it sounds like phonetically. Man and a kind of man.
Right.
In the Bible, you're talking in another language. So sometimes in the Bible, they refer to insan and nas. They use different words. A rajul, a human being. You know, majestic, a physical being. They got many terms, so it's very difficult to do the phonetic trick of man and mankind in Hebrew, Arabic, and Arabic as you do in English. But because the devil used English as a language he would trick people in, that's why it's very easy to see how he used words, like history.
So who do you call a mankind?
Any man who is not the original man is like man. You follow that? And genetic science tells who the original man is, because the color of his skin is determined by the motion of the pigments, how fast the pigments move, all right? And we know that motion is prompted by strength. You got this? In order for you to have fast moving, what we call a pigment, you have to have genetic strength, okay? Strength is gained over a period of time with exercise. So the darker you are, the more stronger you are genetically. And thus, you were here first. White people are not arguing with the fact that their hair is straight because their genes are weak, or that their eyes are blue because their genes are weak, or that their skin is pale because their genes are weak. They're not arguing with the fact that they're the devil.
y'all are trying to argue with the fact that you're the devil because you got a face of the devil ruling the world, and that's kind of frightening. So Patty, we have to keep saying, come on, all right, you can't be bad. What they're really saying is, please tell me all right, you're not bad.
Just mentioned that the angel Gabriel visited the Prophet Muhammad. But did he know that he was an extraterrestrial being?
No, Muhammad thought, like most mortals, that he was an angel. Y'all use the word angel for extraterrestrial. The word terrestrial means things in your Earth's atmosphere. Anything that comes in here is a what? An extra thing here. That's all it means, is an extra thing here. Jesus said extraterrestrial being will come to another man named Muhammad who will be a comfort to you and he'll bring new revelation. He'll be the last one. That's what Jesus said. Another extraterrestrial will come to you. Turn to chapter 16, St. John's chapter 16, verse 7. And this is supposed to be Jesus speaking, and he starts off saying, nevertheless, I tell you the truth.
It's expedient for you that I go away.
It's better for you that I go away.
For if I go not away, the comforter will not come unto you.
Now stop. Jesus made a conditional statement here, and the condition was that if he does not go away, the comforter could not come. You see? Because those two prophets are the same people could be there at the same time because the Quran says to each people I sent a warning. So both of them couldn't be there at the same time for the same people. There'd be a conflict of interest. So Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, could not come while Isa, alayhi salatu wa sallam, was there. We're now moving down to verse 12.
I have yet many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now.
Stop. Jesus told these people, I have a lot of things to teach you, but what?
You cannot bear them now.
You cannot bear them. Then go on. However.
Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth.
That's what the Quran says. See that? Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ar-Rahmanir Rahim. Maliki Yawmiddin. Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in. أهدنا الصراط المستقيم أهدنا الصراط المستقيم أهدنا أهدي هادي الحادي guidance أهدنا الصراط guide us to الصراط المستقيم. That's what he said the comfort is going to do. First chapter of the Quran is from the Fatiha, huh? And it says أهدنا الصراط المستقيم, guide us to the straight and narrow path. أهدنا الصراط المستقيم. You see it? Jesus said it right there. Go ahead. Stop. This prophet will not speak of himself. The angel Gabriel, it's a known fact in Islam. The angel Gabriel, salam alaykum wa rahmatullah, came to Rasulullah Muhammad, the prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the cave and said to Muhammad, Iqra. Wa Muhammad, wa ta'ala, ya Jibrail, ma ana biqariyan. Wa Jibrail, wa ta'ala, aydan, Muhammad, اقرأ. فمحمد قال مرة ثانية يا جبريل ما أنا بقارئ. He said محمد read. He said جبريل I am not a reader. محمد read. He says جبريل I am not a reader. What is he asking this man? What is this extraterrestrial being asking of this man? A very simple statement, right? What is Muhammad saying?
Not a reader.
What does he mean he's not a reader?
Does not know how to read.
That's right. On my own, I cannot do anything. So the angel says to him, which is now the 96th chapter of the Holy Quran, and it's going to be mathematically equated in a way that's unbelievable. Alayha tisata'ashara. Over it is 19. He says to Jibreel, Jibreel says to Rasulullah, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, begin all things in the illustrious name of Allah, He is the Yielder, the Most Merciful. Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. Read by way of using the name of Rabbika, your sustainer, alladhi hu khalaqa, who created. Khalaqa al-insana min alaq. He created all forgetful creatures, insan, people, man. Min alaq, from sperm gushing forth and dividing up. Iqra wa rabbuka al-akram, And we like this, Muhammad, by way of your sustainer, who is Karam, who is so generous. Alladhi alama bil qalam. He is it, for he is rich, as alama taught bil qalam by using a quilt or a pen. Alama linsana ma lam ya'lam. He it is who has taught you forgetful creatures what you could not on your own have learned. Those are the first five verses of the revelation that came to Rasulullah. He put the words in his mouth so that Muhammad would not speak of himself. He made sure that Muhammad just repeated exactly what was being said, so he had no opinion. And Muhammad oftentimes said, I can't say nothing that has not come from Allah Ta'ala throughout the Quran. Most Muslims translate the word Iqra, recite, proclaim. The word Iqra means read. Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. How do you know? You know because by the time it gets down to the fourth verse, it tells you. Alladhi alama alama bil qalam. Alladhi alama bil qalam. Which taught by way of a pen. What do? When something is written with a pen, you read it. You don't recite it. You recite from your head. You orate from your heart. You read from something written. But all these Sunnis keep saying, no, it means recite. That's the devil leading them away from the true meaning. Because they don't want them to know that Muhammad was asked to read the Torah and the Injil before he revealed his Quran. And the Holy Quran in the second chapter supports that to the letter when we get to Surah Al-Baqarah, when it tells you about what was sent down to you, Muhammad, and what was sent down from before you, Muhammad, when it says in the fourth verse of the second chapter, وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ وَمَا أُنزِلَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ وَالَّذِينَ And those who yu'minuna, they believe bima, by way of unzila, what was sent down ilayka to you, Muhammad, wa ma unzila min qablika, and what was sent down before you, Muhammad. Yet you have Muslims all across this country being taught and misinformed by Muslims from overseas who are trying to confuse them into not accepting all of the scriptures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A concentrated effort is being made to confuse people so as not to accept Allah and all of the scriptures that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent down. I don't know what else to say. They read the scriptures, they see what it says, and they still alter their words. Same thing with Christians. They read the scriptures, they see what it says, yet they still choose to alter. This scripture tells you that this is plain and true, that these verses are clear. And it's telling them right there in St. John, chapter 16, all about this man that would come, Muhammad. He would not speak of himself, only that which he hears.
We will continue with True Light after this pause. If you would like a cassette copy of this week's True Light broadcast, send $5 to True Light, 719 Bushwick Avenue, Brooklyn, New York, 11221, and request tape number 19. Now let us return to the True Light with Asaid al-Imam Isa al-Hadi al-Mahdi. Remember, you are the light, and you have the power over all things.
I think this point, because there's a lot of new people there, is one thing we should try to do every week that we gather, is teach something. And I know I meet a lot of people who would like to say this properly and they say it wrong. But I want you all to repeat it. Ready? Say, As-salamu alaykum. As-salamu alaykum. Wa alaykum. Salam. Assalamu alaikum. Wa alaikum salam. Because many people would like to know how to say that and they say it wrong. Every week at the class, for starting, if we take one of these small things and have the brothers write on the blackboard in transliteration and Arabic and see what it means, and it'll start us at least an hour Arabic. Us is A-L. When we use sunlight, we say us, the. Salama, tranquility, bliss, or peace. Assalamu bi alaykum. Upon you all. In Deen Islam, when one Muslim speaks to another, they speak to them in plural out of respect. They don't speak to them in singular. Like when Jesus al-Masih went into the upper room and he said, Salam leka. He was speaking to an individual. In al-Islam, Rasulullah Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam taught us to speak in plural to address you and your two spiritual guides, angelic beings as they refer to them. And say, Assalamu alaikum. Say it. Tranquility or peace be upon you. Let it descend upon you. Or with men, let the Holy Spirit fill you. Assalamu alaikum. Aiden, one more time. Assalamu alaikum. And the answer is, wa alaikum salam. Wa in Arabic means and wa alaikum. And upon you, assalamu, be peace. So your answer to the person is, and may the Holy Spirit descend upon you in peace. So Muslims say to each other, assalamu alaikum. The answer is, wa alaikum salam. Assalamu alaikum. Wa alaikum salam. Assalam alaikum. Wa alaikum salam. You see that? A. A is a hard letter and as is a soft. Assalamu alaikum. Wa alaikum assalam. Everybody, turn to somebody and greet them and answer. Come on, don't be ashamed. How many people messed up? How many people messed up? Let's try it again. Come on, don't be ashamed. Y'all can do it. Assalamu alaikum. Wa alaikum salam. So when the brother comes in and he says to y'all, Assalamu alaikum, what are all y'all supposed to say? That's one thing we got right forever, I hope.
اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق. خلق الإنسان من علق. اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم صدق الله العظيم.
To the unshakable guidance and teachings of Asaid al-Imam Isa al-Hadi al-Mahdi, the undisputed man of our time. No one has allowed themselves to be questioned with such a variety of questions, only to fulfill the eager minds of many in search of the truth. Al-Imam Isa is the author of the most dynamic books in history, dealing with the truth, not theory, philosophies, or fairy tales. Just simple truth to all your questions, no matter what topic. How did Jonah survive 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of the whale? Does the Creator really sit on a throne? What and where is hell? Are angels extraterrestrial beings? Finally, the time has come for the whole truth to be heard. The Nubian Islamic Hebrew Mission would like to invite you to write or send questions to True Light, 719 Bushwick Avenue, Brooklyn, New York, 11221. The public is invited to newcomers class held every Sunday, 1 p.m. to 5 p.m. at the Nubian Islamic Hebrew Mission, 548 Hart Street, Brooklyn, New York. People interested in purchasing these pamphlets of peace can visit our bookstore, Original Tents of Kedar, 719 Bushwick Avenue, Brooklyn, New York, or purchase them from any of our brothers dressed in white, representing the Nubian Islamic Hebrew Mission throughout your city. Again, the address for letters and questions is True Light, 719 Bushwick Avenue, Brooklyn, New York, 11221. Assalamu alaikum.